Yes, and Sitra gave us the assignment to think of what the healthcare could look like in Finland year 2030. You can see our group on the stage at the moment. Here we have Eero Henrikki from the bioinformation technology from Aalto University. On the last corner we have Christian from the Helsinki University Faculty of Medicine, and myself, Nelly, from the information networks from Aalto University. We had the honor to interview some great experts from the field of medicine and science. On this slide you can see our interview is listed. Let's take a quick glance of the structure of our presentation. First we're going to talk a little bit about Finland year 2030, then we're going to jump over to the healthcare system, and afterwards to data and see how these two relate to each other, and the last topics will be e-health and the changing roles within medicine in future. So, we all know we're going to face some challenges within the next 15 years. We have raised some of the challenges on this slide. These were mentioned by all of our interviewees. To tackle these challenges, we need to react and rebuild our existing systems. Otherwise, we're going to face some difficulties. What to do about this then? Christian will tell us a little bit more about the healthcare system's point of view.
Thanks, Nelly. We looked at the Finnish healthcare system from an economical perspective, and we divided our inspection into public and private sectors. Let's take first look on the public sector. As all of us know, the Finnish healthcare system faces some dramatic challenges in the near future. Here are some of the problems that our interviewees brought up. Let's take the weak incentives as an example. In many municipalities, it is often the case that the only target of the healthcare department is just to comply with the minimum requirements of the legislation. It is obvious that this doesn't always lead to decisions that would maximize the health benefits at a populational level. In this other part, we have visioned some of the possible solutions to these problems. For example, integrating services helps in promoting the overall health benefits. As we know, all of the health outcomes are not created in the healthcare sector alone. Let's move on to the private sector. We predict that competition will increase in the private healthcare market. There are three reasons to this: new service concepts, new pricing strategies, and competition from other industries. We have gathered here some case examples from all these three topics. First, Virtuwell, a US-based company, offers fast diagnosis and treatment plan completely online. Below, you can see some savings that they have estimated the patient to make by using the service. Next, Finnish Healthy offers occupational health services at a fixed monthly rate. This gives them the incentive to keep their customers' employees as healthy as possible, and in the case that they do get sick, keep the treatment processes as simple as possible. Beko Terveys is affiliated with the S Group, and they have their practice located at a Prisma supermarket. They offer reward points from their service fees, just as the other sectors in the S Group. So this is clearly a new type of player in the healthcare market. In this figure, we have presented some of the different service models in the healthcare sector. In the left, you can see Virtuwell, which I mentioned earlier, that requires the least contact. And on the right, a traditional health service, such as a doctor's appointment. Great. Next, Henkka will give us some insights about data-driven healthcare.
Thank you, Christian. Okay. So, technology, obviously a great facilitator on the medical field. We can roughly divide it into existing and new technologies. Existing are the ones that are already in clinical use, such as medical imaging in its many appliances. It will get more common in use and cheaper. We could have MRI imaging in your local mall in the future. New technologies, on the other hand, are those that may not have a clinical use yet, but they will get developed further, and in 15 years we could see some new ones being induced. Bioprinting, for an example, is not maybe the most likely one to appear in the next 15 years, but there's a possibility. An important aspect also is our breakthroughs. There's a good example, genome sequencing, which has gone from $100 million per person to mere $1,000 per person in just 15 years. So there's a lot to be gained here, but it's hard to predict what will happen. Next, we will look at big data, a huge buzzword nowadays, and for a good reason. The data explosion is already happening, and it will only increase in speed. There are estimates that by 2020, the world will see tens of billions of terabytes of data, which is obviously an enormous amount, and there's a problem in how are we going to utilize that data. This will obviously also apply to the medical field. By 2030, who knows, the figure could be much bigger. There's also a problem in that we can't really process all this data, even at the current rate of progress. But even the current rate might not keep going. There are estimates that Moore's law will not keep up, and here we see a big problem. But solutions, there may be some, but we don't know yet. Quantum computing, a breakthrough, could solve everything. And next we will look at some examples of how big data is utilized today in medical healthcare. Asmopolis is a company that monitors location and dose data from asthma inhalators and tries to, for example, predict symptoms in patients to pollen in some areas, for example. Influenza obviously has a big impact on the populace, and there are numerous companies trying to predict its spread in the population. Some of them even utilize social media status updates. GMS Healthcare is a company that's trying to predict the outbreak of metabolic syndromes in its patients. And they do this by gathering a large amount of data and looking for risk factors in certain groups of patients. Cancer Research has numerous programs. There's a very large one called the Moonshots program, which has a wide variety of ways that they are utilizing big data, both in research and in treatment. And our final example, Alzheimer. There are companies that are looking at patients' movement data on a daily basis and gathering it to monitor the progress of the disease. And next, Eero will tell us something about e-health.
Thank you, Henkka. We believe that e-health will be an important part of Finnish healthcare in 15 years. And next, we'll show a few examples of possible service concepts. A good example of e-doctor is MeDoc, where you can consult the doctor remotely with a video connection on your phone. This kind of service improves the availability of medical services. For example, specialists can treat patients anywhere in the world. Next, we'll have e-measurements. The Taito platform and device is a good example of this. It will be released soon at around a $200 price rate. You can, for example, take a picture of your throat and ears and send it to the doctor, who can use it to diagnose remotely. The point of virtual health check and coaching is that it's available anytime, anywhere. And it requires no active work from a professional. A good example of this is Duodecim's electronic health check and coaching, where first you'll fill a survey of questions about your lifestyle, and then you'll get an individual lifetime expectancy and a 12-week coaching program to improve your lifestyle habits. Remote monitoring and sensors enable faster return from the hospital. They can also be used in the treatment of chronic diseases. Good example is Google's and Novartis contact lens for diabetics, which allow continuous blood sugar measurement. One of the biggest pros of e-health is that it saves the patient's time. You don't have to wait at the health center. It's also one way of enabling services for less populated areas of Finland, for example. And there are, of course, limitations to, for example, you can't take a blood test on a remote connection, now at least. And the attitudes of people are a question mark. Will they allow this new type of service to blossom? And here are the different services by their need for professionals and their need for premises. And next, Christian will tell us about the changing roles.
Thanks, Eero. In this last part, we will talk about the changing roles in healthcare. The role of the patient is going to increase, and there are two reasons to this. First, the amount of easily accessible medical information will continue to increase, and we will have better informed patients. Second, the patients will gather more personal health data from themselves. Both these changes still require some kind of attitude change from both the professionals and the patients. And in this slide, we have presented four factors that influence the development of the role of the doctors. All these issues, such as medical education, should be carefully considered when developing the future healthcare system. And to finish this up, Nelly will give us some concluding remarks.
So, here's a finishing off graph. We have gathered some of the already existing phenomena and future phenomena on this graph. On the x-axis, you can see the likeliness that the phenomenon has to emerge. And on the y-axis, you can see the effect we consider the phenomenon to have on overall healthcare of the society. For example, we have the structural changes over here, which we think will affect the society widely and are almost inevitable to merge. Then again, we have the integration of the information systems, which we do think would have a great effect, but at least during the next 15 years, we don't consider that as a likely phenomenon to emerge. To finish off, we would like to thank you for your patience, and thank Ville Koiste for the great and active support we have received throughout the project. And we're of course interested in discussing these topics on a more detailed level. And if you have any questions, don't hesitate to come and ask after Kristiina's presentation. We'll be out of the door and on your left-hand side. Thank you.